How are you? I hope everybody's doing good. I wanted to pop on today to address prolapse and address specifically my story because I've had a few people asking about it lately, and I thought it would be maybe helpful for me to tell you a little bit more about about my story. I know I've shared it before, but I also realize that not everybody has followed everything I've done from the beginning. And so, if you're curious and you don't know my story, maybe it would be helpful for you to actually know kind of my journey and what I've been through and how I've maintained my pelvic health for the last 13 years. So, it's something that I don't talk about enough. Honestly, I probably should share about it more because I think that I tend to share other people's inspiring stories, like my clients and that kind of thing. And I love sharing those stories about success that, successes that my clients have had and that kind of thing. But I never really talk about myself. And recently I realized, my gosh, it's actually pretty impressive that I developed prolapse 13 years ago, almost 14 years ago, when my son was born. And I today feel completely not limited by the condition. I'm asymptomatic. So I need to talk about that more. And I need to let people know that, not only have I seen success stories in so many people that I've worked with, but I am my own success story. And I want to talk about that today. So again, if you have any questions, just let me know. But I received a message from somebody who reached out and said, "When did you have prolapse? Do you ever feel it anymore? Did you use a pessary? What kind of prolapse?" That kind of thing. So here's the story. So about my son is almost 14. Sorry, my cat is on the table and she's probably gonna knock my phone down. But my son's almost 14. When I gave birth to him, I ran throughout most of my pregnancy. Not that that necessarily means anything, but just to paint a picture of who I was, as I was a real runner. And so I ran throughout pregnancy and then I had my son and I was completely sleep deprived. New mom, first time mom. I only have one child, but I didn't know what I was doing. Anybody who's a mom knows how it is when you have your first child. It's like, what is this? It's completely a different world and you're exhausted. And I just desperately wanted to get back to my normal life. I wanted to get back to running because I felt like a piece of me was missing. I felt so tired. I felt just out of sorts. And so I went running just a couple, 2 to 3 weeks after giving birth, and it was way too early. And I immediately felt the prolapse. I felt this and I thought, oh, expletive right there. I'm like, oh no, what just happened? I know what just happened. And the reason I knew is because I actually was training to specialize in pelvic floor physical therapy. So I'm a doctor of physical therapy and I was going through the training I needed, the coursework I needed to really specialize in pelvic health. So I knew exactly what I'd done. And I knew better than to go on a run that early postpartum, but I just thought that it didn't apply to me. The rules didn't apply to me because I was fit and I was a physical therapist. And so the rules didn't apply to me for some reason, right? It's not how it works. But anyway, so I went home and I checked myself and I confirmed that it was a cystocele, a bladder prolapse. Pretty mild. I mean, it wasn't like protruding outside of the vagina, but it was definitely, it was definitely visible and I could feel it. I could see it bulge down when I bared down or bore down, like coughing. You can see that bulge. Again, it wasn't protruding outside of the vagina, so that was good, but I definitely knew there had been a change and a shift. And so I went to my midwife and asked her, and she totally blew me off and said, "It's no big deal. There's nothing wrong." Of course, examined me lying down, so that's not exactly the most functional position. That happened actually a couple of times. I went back and asked a couple of times, "Do I have prolapse? Like, what do you see? Do I have this?" And every time I was told, "No, it's not a big deal. Don't worry about it. It's nothing." But I knew better and I knew something felt funny. And so, luckily, I had total awareness of my body and my anatomy and the pelvic floor. And I knew what to do because I was in training. I was really lucky because I was training to specialize in pelvic floor physical therapy. And so I actually used the information that I was learning to help treat my patients to create my own, just, I mean, it wasn't like a program really. It's just what I put together, like some exercises, and I started really thinking about how I was lifting and moving and transitioning from sit to stand and holding my baby and, you know, my posture and all of these things. And I stopped running because for my body at that time, it wasn't the right time. That was clear. And so I did all of this work and I got better. And it was amazing. Like, I really just stopped thinking about it. And partly it was because I had such belief. Like, I actually didn't even really question it, to be honest with you. I was pretty clear that, like, this is all good. I've got this. I've got it figured out. I had such zeal as a new physical therapist. I was still pretty new to the profession in general, and then really new to pelvic floor physical therapy. And I was working with patients, you know, soon after I got off maternity leave, I was working with patients again, and I was, you know, just so stoked about what I was doing. I'm like, of course I'm going to be fine. So I had complete belief and faith that I'd get better, and I had a really good awareness of my body and anatomy, and knowing how to contract and relax the muscles and all of that stuff. And so I was able to treat myself using my own medicine that I treated my patients with, exercise and lifestyle. And the other thing I did was give it time. And through the course of natural postpartum healing, and once I weaned, I wasn't actually, unfortunately, able to breastfeed for very long. And so I wish I'd been able to breastfeed for longer, but it was only about 6 weeks that it just wasn't working for either one of us. And so because I could only breastfeed for that long, and I pumped for a while after that, but my hormones re-regulated, you know, after I fully weaned my son. And then just natural healing took place. And then, like I said, all of the things that I was doing for exercise and lifestyle. So I was completely symptom-free after a couple months. I was completely symptom-free. So I don't remember. It was so long ago that I'd say maybe like 3 to 4 months of really kind of focusing on exercise and lifestyle, and then the weaning and the natural healing and all of that. It didn't take that long. I mean, granted, it wasn't in an instant, but it didn't take that long. Now, the super duper cool thing that I want to share here is that because I am a pelvic floor physical therapist, and I was working at the time, I was working in a clinic every single day with people who had prolapse and bladder leakage and all of these issues that I knew I could help with. But every single person I worked with, I'm like telling myself the same things and reminding myself of the importance of living a lifted, I call it now living a lifted lifestyle. So my program that I developed is called Lift, but it's all about living a lifestyle, because your lifestyle is the 99% of the day that you're not exercising. That's really what adds up. Your posture. So right now I'm hunched over because I'm like, my phone is low, and so I'm like hunchy. That's not good. And I know that that's not good. I actually need to be lifted up. But those are the types of things that I started really preaching and telling all of my patients about. And so by default, I remembered to do these things. They became a part of my life and just my habit. So thank God. Thanks to all of my patients who I worked with every day, because it reminded me every day, oh yeah, like I need to actually make this part of my lifestyle too. I need to stand correctly. I need to transition correctly. I need to lift correctly. If I do it wrong, I need to put it down and try again. I need to not push when I go to the bathroom, you know, when I pee. Try not to push when I poop. You know, try to do all of these things that I was telling my patients every day. Try to do it myself too. And I did, and it became just part of my life. And that's why. So, I mean, this is really what I really wanted to say today is I shared a picture on, or a video on my stories yesterday. It might still be up there, I don't know. But it's a picture of me doing a weightlifting move where I'm like, it's not really that impressive, maybe, but it kind of felt impressive. It's like a squat where I have a pretty heavy weight. It's 30 pounds. So for me, that's pretty heavy, but it's a deep squat, and my feet are up on yoga blocks. And I'm holding the weight between my hands, and my back is flat, and I've got, you know, good form. And I'm just like doing a deep plie squat, essentially, but my feet are up on yoga blocks. So you've really got to get that weight down there. It's kind of intense. And I thought to myself, you know, I want to share with people that the reason I can do that, the reason I can also go for a run when I want to go for a run. Now, I'm not really super into running anymore. I mean, that was my life, was before my child. Running was my life. But now I I pretty much walk, and sometimes I run little intervals, that kind of thing. But I dance, I do yoga, I do all sorts of crazy yoga moves. But the reason why is because I've discovered that you have to maintain. And so the reason I'm able to do these things today is that I took the time to make the changes early on, and I had patience and belief and faith, and then I kept living my lifted lifestyle and I kept maintaining. And it wasn't like it was hard, like I had to do some prescription sets and reps of certain exercises every day. Really, it was just a matter of learning how to integrate my pelvic floor into my daily life and to integrate awareness of my pelvic floor and the pressure in my abdomen into my regular exercises. So I could go do whatever exercises I wanted to do, but I knew this feels good and this feels bad. So I want to stay away from the things that feel bad and I want to only do the things that feel good. And so that's why. So maintenance is one thing I wanted to just touch on today, the importance of understanding that once you get better, you have to keep maintaining, but it doesn't have to be a big chore to maintain your pelvic health. It's just a matter of integrating it into your lifestyle. So that's the first thing I wanted to say. The second thing I wanted to say is about the, gosh, what was it? Now I don't remember what I was going to say. Oh, just the importance of the first pillar of really what I try to teach people in my LIFT program. The very first pillar is awareness and identification of the pelvic floor, and also learning how to relax and let go. So if you don't know where your pelvic floor even is, and you don't know how to let it go, you're not going to be able to gain strength, and certainly not going to be able to maintain strength over the long run. So I want to share one more story with you, and that's to follow on the question that the gal had for me. She was asking me about my prolapse, and she said, "Did it ever come back?" And so this is where I want to get really real with you. I did become symptomatic not long ago, like a couple months ago. I became symptomatic again after years, after 13, almost 14 years of no symptoms at all. And thank God I, first of all, have, the awareness and knowledge that I have today. But what I realized, and I'll make it a short story, but there's a long version and there's a short version. The short version is that I was developing a whole lot of pelvic tension due to stress. I was really stressed and anxious about some things in my life. And I know I've shared this before, but if this is new to you, if you haven't heard this before from me, stress, the first place that our body feels fear, emotions, stress, one of the first places reflexively, like this, I keep snapping my fingers today because that's what it is. We don't even have to think about it. It's not really conscious, it's subconscious, is our pelvic floor. So if you think about if you were gonna get like hurt, like, I don't know, if something was gonna hurt you, you curl up into a ball like this. And the first thing that makes that motion happen is your pelvic floor tenses up. Now, even if you're not actually physically curling into a ball, if you feel stress and anxiety and overwhelm in your life, this is really what your body wants to do. Like, this move is what wants to happen. But because we are living in the real world, we can't walk around like that all day. And so, even if it's just micro, and completely unconscious, our pelvic floor is one of the first things to just get a little bit of tension going, just a little bit of clenching that we don't even probably aren't aware of. And again, it's not making us look necessarily funny. Like, we don't necessarily look like we're doubled over, but it's there and it's happening. And when that tension happens, if you have any, because even though my prolapse was not symptomatic for 14 years, I'm quite certain that my organs, my bladder is still slightly shifted from where it was when I was 16 years old. I think it's a little lower. It's a little lower. Was it symptomatic? No, not at all, but it's a little lower. And so when I started developing extreme tension in the pelvic floor, a few months ago, it was squeezing around my shifted organs. It was squeezing around things. It was making my bladder feel like I felt like I had a UTI. I didn't. But I felt like it was, my bladder was constantly urgent, like I had to use the bathroom a lot to go pee. I felt urgency and frequency and just irritation. I didn't want to have sex. It felt really like irritated. I felt heavy. I was so nervous that my prolapse had come back. And I was embarrassed because I was like, this is my job. I help people not have prolapse. I have a program called Lift that helps people get over their prolapse. I'm good at what I do. Why did this happen to me? Why is it back? I mean, it was really scary. And what I noticed in that time is that not only was it aching, 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 and it just felt yucky. Like again, that bladder urgency and the aching. And I started actually touching, I was checking all the time too. That's another thing is I was constantly checking, like, oh my gosh, do things look different down there? Like with a mirror and with my hands, checking. And I got really preoccupied and really anxious about what was going on. And so there are a few things had to happen. The first thing that had to happen is I had to stop checking. I had to completely stop checking and I had to just say, Brianne, chill out. Like it's gonna be okay. So that was the very first thing I did is I told myself, stop checking, and I forced myself to stop. And then the other thing I did is I started noticing the tension in my perineum, the area between the vagina and the anus, that muscular area. I literally felt like I had a golf ball knot of tension in that part of my body. And so I did some work to release that tension, and it did not happen overnight. It did not release overnight. It took probably, I would say these symptoms started developing over a couple of months. They started getting worse and worse. And in order to relieve these symptoms, it took me to stop checking my mirror constantly, down there. It took me to work on releasing these muscles with my hand, just, simple massage. Honestly, it was just like massaging a knot of tension in your neck. It was just easy. And I did deep breathing and I did meditation and I worked on relaxing the pelvic floor even more than I'd done before. And I still did exercises. I still, mine wasn't so bad. If somebody has really terrible pelvic pain and tension, I will usually advise for them to maybe hold off on some of the more core strengthening work and focus primarily on letting go. But for me, it would like I felt like because I have good awareness of my body, I felt like I could still do certain exercises that do require zipping up your core or, certain move like yoga moves that are balance moves that really require some core pelvic floor activation. But I also knew the importance of relaxing afterwards and really spending like doubling up the time to relax and let go. Did a lot of deep breathing, did that manual therapy on my perineum, a little bit like inside the vagina, like just a little bit of release work, but really a lot of it was just on the outs, like in the perineum, like the muscles, the outer area. I didn't even have to go inside necessarily. So I did all of that. And one day, here's how it goes for me. This happens in so many areas of my life. It's there, 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 it's gone. And that happened to me here. Like, it's like I did the work, I did the work, I felt fear. I'm like, oh, crud, what is going on with me? Then I decided, release the fear, do the work, release the fear, but do what you know you need to do. Okay, I'm doing what I need to do. It's not working, it's not working, it's not working. Keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. Stop being scared, just keep going. And I did. And all of a sudden, one day, gone. Completely gone. And it was, I remember the day that I was like, wait a minute. I don't feel any urgency. I don't feel any frequency in my bladder. I don't feel that heaviness. And I went and checked with the mirror that I hadn't picked up in forever. And I'm like, I don't, it looks like fine. Like, I mean, there's nothing like, it doesn't look weird. And I had completely zero symptoms. And since that day, it hasn't come back. So again, to answer the question, do I have prolapse today? I don't know. I probably do. Like I said, I probably do have some degree of pelvic shift of my bladder and my urethra. I think, it's probably, like I said, a little lower than it was when I was 16. But am I symptomatic? No. Was I symptomatic a couple months ago? Yes. And it scared me. But here's what I know to be true is that the reason I was symptomatic is because of tension and stress and holding in my body that was squeezing around everything. And because I have awareness of my body and I know when my muscles feel tight and I know how to let them go, I was able to help that. And so again, that's why I said at the earlier that one of the big pillars of the work that I try to teach people and I try to impart is awareness and just identification of your pelvic floor is one of the most important first steps. And so whether you do my lift program or whether you do my Kegel camp, which you can find for free on YouTube, just start with day one. But in these programs, the first thing I always do is like, okay, here's where your pelvic floor is. Like, here's where it is. And let's just feel it. And let's actually learn how to relax it and let it go and release. And then we can start building up strength. But the first thing you need to do is be aware of it and know how to let it go because of exactly what I've just told you. You know, the first thing is, because in order to successfully work it, you need to know where it is and how to let it go. But also, life is long and pelvic health maintenance is for life. And you do need to integrate the lifted lifestyle and, you know, integrate your pelvic floor into your daily exercises, because there you're getting your, you don't have to do necessarily isolated Kegel exercises. You just integrate your pelvic floor into the some of the exercises and moves you do all day long, like sit to stand. Every time you move from sit to stand, you activate your pelvic floor. There's a Kegel and you didn't even need to do a Kegel. I mean, you did, but not like think of doing a Kegel exercise. And it's so much better anyway, because you integrate it with the other muscles of your core. So you learn how to incorporate pelvic health maintenance into your daily life, and then you're going to be good. But then life happens, and there are ups and downs, and there are highs and lows, and maybe sometimes things are going to happen, like you're going to get really stressed, and it's going to cause symptoms. But if you know what to look for, and you know how to let it go, and you know how to tune into your body and really feel and be like, oh, okay, maybe that's what's going on, then you actually have the power to be your own healer, to figure it out. And you can always come to people like, you know, a physical therapist in your area, pelvic floor physical therapist that you can work with, or, you know, do a program like one of my programs that I offer, or, you know, you can look to somebody who's an expert, look to outside sources. But I just want you to understand that when you have these pillars in place, when you have that first pillar of identification and awareness of your pelvic floor and learning how to let go, you actually have the power to completely do most of the healing completely on your own. Like, the power is in your hands. It's not in my hands. It's, you know, that might be controversial for some people to hear, because I think we like to give our power away, you know, it's easier, but you have the power. It just takes learning how to tune in and learning how to trust yourself. And so that's, to wrap it up, I will wrap it up here, but that's my prolapse story. Is that's how I fixed it. And I was stayed better for 13, 14 years. Then it came back. Well, again, the symptoms came back, but then I was able to fix it again. And I am no different than any of you. I am not more special than any of you. I just happen to be able to feel these muscles, and you can do that too with a little bit of training and awareness. So that's my story. And I'm gonna see if there's any questions.